Welcome to CrossPoint. Would you guys stand and worship with us? My name is Mike. This is Sammy. We're a couple of the worship leaders here. We and the rest of the team are so excited you're here. I want to welcome everyone at the Dream Center, all the ladies of God behind bars, and all of you joining us online. We're so glad you're here. Come on. Get those hands going. To repaying. You know, I think a lot of us feel a little bit uncomfortable when it comes to moving or dancing. It might seem a little foreign, but you guys, it goes all the way back to the Bible where David was dancing before the Lord because he was unhindered, and it was an outward expression of the overflow that was coming out of him. So as we continue to sing these words, you guys, we're gonna ask you to move as an act of worship this morning, all right? This is a moment to remind ourselves exactly what Jesus did, and it's our opportunity to say thank you. Would you guys sing these words? I hear the Savior say,
Savior say, thy strength in thee is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me my all in all.
What's in a name? What is a name outside of the grouping of letters that we use to identify each other? A name can be more than just the sound of alphabetical symbols strung together. Throughout history, there have been many names that are associated with God. Emmanuel, God is with us. Adonai, Lord or Master. El Shaddai, Lord God Almighty. But God gave himself a name in the book of Exodus. That name was Yahweh, which is translated into I am. Did you know that when you sing hallelujah, that Yah is really the Yah in Yahweh? So it's hallelujah, which means praise be to, plus Yah, which means God. Hallelujah, praise God. You also see that piece of God's name in another name. That same Yah becomes the J in Jesus. The sus means salvation or saves. So Jesus' name literally means God saves. That's part of what makes his name so great. It's the name that God chose for himself, put into action. It's the name that can bring healing and break down walls. It's the name that brings beauty from ashes and causes dead, dry bones to come to life. And it's the name of our Savior King that came down from heaven to be near each one of us. It's a powerful name. It's a beautiful name. It's the name that's worthy of all our praise.
Church, that when we come here to gather together, we get to praise the only one who is worthy of all the glory and of all the honor. So let's declare this truth together, that even death could not hold our God. Sing this with me.
Death could not hold.
Love.
trust the name of Jesus. Would you guys sing these words with me?
We need no other hiding place. Our hope is safe within your name. This we know. This we know.
And you promise.
Promise never to forsake.
Yes, Lord.
What you began, you will sustain.
And this we know.
This we know. This we know.
Jesus' name. Thank you guys so much for worshiping with us. You can have a seat. Well, what's up, CrossPoint? How are we doing this morning? Awesome. Well, we are glad you're here. My name is Zach, and I'm one of the pastors here. And if it is your first time here, thanks for being our guest today. There's really two things I would like for you to know. First of all, after the service, if you'll stop by one of our new here stations out in the lobby, there's a volunteer waiting there who would love to hear a little bit of your story and give you a free gift just to say thanks for being with us. And then coming up on October 24th, we have our next Connecting at CrossPoint event. And if you're new to CrossPoint, this is a great event for you to be a part of. Two of the questions we often hear, and maybe you felt before stepping into a new church or a new organization, is how do I get more involved and how do I get to meet other people? That's what the 24th is all about. So if you're new, or even if you've been here for a while, make sure you make a note of that. You can sign up online later today. It's going to be incredible. Well, you may or may not know that every Wednesday night here at CrossPoint, our student ministry meets, and that's for 7th through 12th graders. And they've got everything from food and basketball to small groups to a life-changing worship experience, much like we see here on a Sunday morning. But I love hearing the stories of the way that God is working in the lives of our students, believing that we are investing in the next generation. I was talking to Cody, our student pastor, this last week, and he told me the story of Ladarius, who's one of our seniors, a part of our student ministry here. And a couple weeks ago, Ladarius came to him and said, "Hey man, there's a guy sitting up on the corner of Jefferson and Cowan. Could I go invite him to church?" Cody was like, "Yeah, of course. Take somebody else with you." And so they walked up to the corner, they invited him to church. He came, he had a great experience. But what that represents is more than just an invitation. What that represents is what God is doing in Ladarius's life. Let me connect the dots. When we invest here at CrossPoint, when we give, when we're obedient with our resources, it allows us to create experiences in places like our student ministry where a kid like Ladarius can have his heart and his life changed by God. So as I invite our greeters to come forward, yeah, we can celebrate that. As I invite our greeters to come forward, and as we have the opportunity to give back today, let's do it with that heart and mind, that we invest and we give, not only out of obedience, but because we know it could change a kid's heart like Ladarius, and it can change our city. So thank you so much for believing in the next generation, for believing in this church, and for seeing incredible ways that it's changing our city. Speaking of our city, we've talked a lot about some of the things that are going on here at CrossPoint and how we want to continue to love our city. And one of the things we've said is in this time of transition, we're trying to keep you guys kind of up to date on what's going on with transition. So in a moment, we're going to talk about Serve the City. But before I do that, I want to let you guys know that we are praying a lot about transition here at CrossPoint, our elders and our leadership team, about what's the next best step here at CrossPoint. And so one of the questions we get a lot is, who are the elders? Who's the leadership team who's helping us through these seasons? We've actually put together a great website landing page that you can go and find out more information. Here's what I want you to know. Two things we need from you in this season. Trust. Trust that God is with us and that he's got the best days ahead for us and he knows the right next leader for us here at CrossPoint. And then pray. Pray along with us. Pray that God would bring the right person and that our leadership team and our elders would be able to step into that and we would see God continue to do incredible things here. But we've told you, Serve the City's coming up. So Jordan's here. He's our community pastor.
Let's just acknowledge that I awkwardly walked out way too soon.
Yeah, that was completely my fault.
Sorry about that,
not
guys.
Actually your fault. Serve the City coming up this Saturday. Jordan, give us in one sentence what's Serve the City.
It's this awesome day. We activate hundreds of you guys just to go out and simply do good in our city and all around our city.
Yeah, so, all right, it's the South. And I've heard that in the South, football on Saturdays is a big deal. So let's just acknowledge, it's 8 o'clock to 12 o'clock. Are we really going to be done by lunch?
Guys, you will be done by noon, so that way you can watch, which will probably be one of my teams from Alabama.
Yeah? Too soon.
Too soon.
Yes.
Hitting off that 2:30 SEC game. Sorry, guys. It's the truth there.
Jokes aside, though, I love the fact that just in 3 or 4 hours, an investment of our time in that way literally could have an impact on somebody's story. So 8 to 12 this Saturday, it's going to be amazing. How could we sign up practically today?
Three easy ways. First way, on your way out to the lobby, there'll be somebody in a red shirt. Grab them, tell them you're interested. They'll take care of you. Or at any time, you can go to crosspoint.tv/serve. You can register yourself, your group, your friends, anybody. Or very easily today, you can fill out one of these cards before you go, drop it off in the lobby, and we'll get you guys taken care of.
Okay, so I need everyone to take out one of these cards right now. You should have gotten one on the way in, because at the very bottom, there is a scratch-off part. So this is kind of like playing the lotto, only no billions of dollars. So you get the idea, right? Instead, you can win
a
free shirt.
Yes.
Cool?
It's a good-looking
shirt. On the count of three, everyone go ahead and scratch off the bottom of that. See if you are the lucky winner. If you are, go ahead and stop by Connecting Points out in the lobby to pick up your shirt. But more importantly, sign up on the back of that so that you can be a part of Serve the City this Saturday. Thanks so much, Jordan. It's going to be an incredible day. Well, today we are continuing in our series that we kicked off last week. And I'm excited because today we get to hear from a friend, Miles Adcox. He's a part of our church community here. He has an incredible heart for people. Organizations all across the country call on Miles for his wisdom, his knowledge. And I heard this message last service. This is an incredible message. So grab your pens, grab your notes. Welcome to week two of Why.
It all starts with one question. One word that can restore or destroy our view of the past. One word that can ignite or implode our sense of purpose for the future. Without it, we find exertion without traction, sleep without rest, striving without meaning. It's at the center of humanity's shared groaning. We can try to ignore it and bury it, but it won't stay where we put it. Why? In every journey, every failure, every new season, every morning, why? Why don't we endure the suffering? Why do we go through the pain? Why are we always kept in waiting? Why press on when hope seems lost? And why do we always feel that we have to go through it alone? And what is it that drives us and causes us to strive for a better life? For a better world. Because if you don't know your why, you never get to your how. You don't get to the where or when. And that means who is never you. Without your why, fear will overtake you. The doubts will keep you seated. The confusion will keep you silent. And then your passion will leave you. Your why has to be big enough to cover every disappointment. Your why has to be your anchor. Your why is your foundation. Why press on? Why keep going? Because you did not come this far just to come this far. You were never meant for less than what you were meant for. You are not your past. You are not your shame. You are not your worst days. You are not as weak as your failures. You are as strong as your why.
Hey, CrossPoint family, it's Bob Goff here. I am so delighted that we got to spend a little time together last week and ask about questions about why. No better friend than the buddy you get to talk to today, Miles Adcox. He's been a guy who's been there for me at times where I was desperately confused and asking questions about why, and you're gonna find him to be a calm, humble voice. Enjoy my friend Miles. So long, you guys.
Morning. Doesn't he just make you smile? That's all you got to do is just watch him and just smile. So, wow, welcome you guys here in Nashville and all the campuses and everybody online. I got to tell you, it's just an honor to be here. It's an honor and it's also humbling. It's humbling to be up here in front of you. We're going to be talking today. Last week we talked about love, and this week we're going to be talking about grace. And grace for me is one of my favorite concepts and one of the hardest things to live. In other words, I love to tell you about it, and I love to teach it, and I like to give it. Receiving it is a whole other animal. And so what I hope we do today in the next 20, 30 minutes together is, how do we close the gap? How do we move from this perception of who we are and who we've been and the why of how to get where we're going? How do we close the gap? Because my experience teaches me that the gap often is rooted in our worth. And I don't know about you, but when it comes to my worth, I'm often my own worst critic. And when I ask the question why, it usually gets pretty uncomfortable and awkward. And it gets quiet. And it gets hard. Because what my instincts want to do is do one of two things. I either want to run, armor up, and that can look different for all of us, but typically we have our own form of armor, which is, here's what I want you to see, but here's what's really going on. Or I want to push through as fast as I can. Because hope is a lot easier than pain. Hope is a lot easier than change. And the faster that I can get to hope, the less discomfort I have to sit in. Well, my experience tells me, and I get the great fortune to work with a lot of people going through a lot of different circumstances. Change, pain, struggle. I get the opportunity, and I say the opportunity because there is nothing like sitting across from someone and seeing them at their worst and showing them their best. Because my experience is this. I don't think grace, unconditional grace, should be reserved for those of us lucky enough to have a wheels falling off moment. And I've had them. I've face planted. And I've fallen. And I know many of you have too. And today, actually, you might be doing it right here in your seat right now. You may show up here today in some pain or in some struggle or in some questions. I know we're all showing up in change because we're in transition and change. And you may be visiting today and you may not know that, but that's the beauty of what the foundation of my friend Pete stood up here and talked to us about in this leadership that is still standing here talking about, is that we will be firmly rooted in grace and unconditional love. That's who we are. That's who we are, CrossPoint. And what I want to know and what I'm curious about is, we talk about it. What happens when we need it? What happens when we need it? How do we get there? What if it was as simple as closing the gap between our misperceptions and the questions that we have? And so I want to show you this. I got a call from Bob last year, and he said, you never know what's going to happen when Bob calls. But he called and he said, hey man, there's some people that are going through some big tragedy and a lot of pain. And I want to go help them out. I want to go love on them, and I want to give them some grace, and I need you to help me. We're setting up some refugee camps and setting up some schools, and would you be willing to go help me? And I didn't think a lot of it, honestly. I just thought, okay, sure, yeah, what are we doing? I didn't even ask a lot about it. Well, I got my agenda emailed in, I think, a week later, and we weren't going to California. We were going to Iraq. How many people, show of hands here or at any of the campuses, have been to Iraq? See, one. So not many. And so I want you to do this. Get a picture in your mind of what you feel like Iraq looks like. And tell me when you got it. Head nods. First thing that comes to my mind when I think of Iraq is what I've seen and what I've read. War-torn, desert, one of the most dangerous places in the world. Some of the scariest people in the world. I did not expect to see this, so welcome to Iraq. We flew into northern Iraq, Kurdistan, And I got to tell you, some of the most misunderstood, kicked out, shut out, killed communities in the world are the Kurds. And they are the bravest, most hospitable people I've ever met. So you talk about a misperception. I was terrified to go. I almost backed out. I listened to everything everybody told me. Don't go. It's not the time. Don't go. You might not come home. Don't go. It's dangerous. And so me and a buddy, there was another guy from Nashville, Don, that went, a good friend. And as we were preparing for this trip, we were trying to figure out how to fit in. And so we grew beards out. We were like, they won't see us. So we land in northern Iraq, and I'll never forget walking out of the airport that day, and we were the only two dudes with beards within 100 miles. It's like, no! So we shaved the first day. But there was this misperception. And I met really kind people. And was it dangerous? Absolutely. We were 30 miles from the front lines. ISIS had just taken Mosul, and we were there to help set up some ISIS refugee camps. But there was something different there than what I had made up it was going to be. And so, day one, the people on the ground there, and here we come with resources, with a little bit of knowledge, and with a lot of hope. We were there to bring grace and love. And I just thought that's what everybody wanted. I thought that's what they needed. And maybe they did, but what they wanted more than that was they wanted us to see this. And so they asked. Day one, we want to take you up to show you one of the most beautiful places in Iraq. Well, that wasn't part of the agenda. And we had to stick to the agenda because anything outside of the agenda could be perceived as what? Dangerous. You don't go one way in, one way out. You don't take trips like that. And so we said no. Thank you, but no. And we got back to our agenda, which is how do we bring all this stuff to you? Day two, we want you to go see this. No, we'd love to, we just can't do it. Day three, can we take you to one of the most beautiful places in all of Iraq? And suddenly it dawned on us that maybe, and for some reason, it was more important to them for us to see this than it was any of the resources we could bring them. And so we said yes. And we left at 5 in the morning, and it was pitch black, went switchback all the way up this mountain. And right as the sun was coming up, I had my phone, and I was ready to get a picture. Because all I'd heard about was how beautiful it was. And all I thought was how dangerous it was. And I said, I want to tell this story. I can't wait. You know, I was like, this is Instagram worthy. I can't wait to get this moment. Well, when the sun came up over the mountain, in every direction, I saw this. Hundreds of these. And what I saw, first thought wrong, was obstacle. This is in my way of getting what I want, which is a picture. And literally it was. Like I'm doing like this, scanning, and in every direction I turn, there's these two signs right here that are getting in the way of what I see is on the other side of them, which is this beautiful, green, lush landscape. That's what I wanted. I didn't want to deal with this. And so I start walking towards it, blindly. I'm just like... And the guy with us, you know, he says, whoa, 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 stop. Some of you may have been able to pick up that the skull and crossbones might have said stop, but I didn't. I was, why? I was firmly locked on my agenda. And I'm way more comfortable getting on the other side of that. He explained, keep your distance. In the Iraq-Iran conflict in the 80s, Saddam Hussein littered the mountains with these. And they're landmines. And today, kids get limbs blown off from playing in their backyard. Still, today. Suddenly, what initially was an obstacle turned into an opportunity, and it was an opportunity that saved my life. So you see how my perception quickly changed about this sign when I understood what was beneath the surface? And so I would ask you this, and I'm asking myself this, what's your sign? What's beneath the surface for you? What is it that we don't get permission to talk about or tell people? Because we want them so badly to see what's on the other side of it. My experience is this. Change, struggle, pain, require one thing. People ask me all the time, they say, how do you get me through it? How do you get me through pain? I need to get through change. How do you get me through struggle? I don't get people through it, I get people in it. I get people to walk in and take a look at it. And the only way we do that, the only way we go arm in arm with people, is with this formula. The only thing that matters is your faith expressed in love. To me, that's been the foundational component for grace. The only thing that matters is your faith expressed in love. It's not easy, but it's simple. Because what you don't know is in the silent moments when I'm not trying to armor up and show you what I know and show you how smart I am and try to qualify myself so that I can be okay, is that I stand up here as a helping professional. I do get to walk arm in arm with people going through big transitions and change. And every time I walk through the door, I feel unqualified. I feel insecure. And I feel like if they only knew. And I would say that to you, if you only knew who's standing up here talking to you, you wouldn't trust me. You couldn't trust me. Because you know I don't have a message that you all deserve to hear that could support you. Fear. But guess what? Fear is not the problem. And what I want to do with that message, what I want to do with that script, that old script, that worst script that drags, that follows me around, is I want to sucker punch it or scissor kick it. I'm like, you're out. And that's what we try to do to fear, is we try to kick it out. Does it go anywhere in your experience? Fear is not the problem, it's our relationship with fear. When I put down the microscope and start looking at the expectations in which I think the people around me demand and start looking in the mirror at who I am and who I'm becoming, then I get to experience and receive grace, not just talk about it and give it. That's when the gap closes in my experience, is when we start to practice what we're asking people to do, when we mirror and model. And we, man, you talk about having an opportunity. We have an opportunity right now. One of the most decorated runners to come out of Europe is a guy named Derek Redmond. He broke a lot of world records, favored to medal in the Olympics in 1988, right before he had a, not season ending, it was a career ending injury. He went through multiple surgeries and got back up, showed up in 1992 at the Olympics, and favored to medal. And this is what happened.
You raise me up to walk on stormy seas.
never get tired of seeing that. If you're a father or if you have dad issues, that probably just crushed you. Sorry. So I would ask you this. In ministry and service and in leadership, and we're all that, believe it or not. We didn't get here today by not being leaders. Everybody that sits here is a leader, whether you're visiting or you've been here for a week or 10 years. Who do you relate to most in that story? Is it Derek Redmond or his father? I've been in the helping profession for about 15 years. And as I said, I get to see people a lot when they fall. And I'd like to tell you that I relate to Derek Redmond's father, because that's what we do. Somebody goes down, we walk alongside them, we walk with them. And that's what I set out to do, but I got to be honest, that's not how I always act. Most of the time, I'm more like Derek. Derek is admirable. It's amazing. I mean, he's a freak of nature. He's a one percenter. I mean, who does that? You know what he did after that? They told him he'd never compete in sports again, and he tried out for the basketball team. He was on the Olympic basketball team the next guy. And now he goes around and talks to kids about hope and resilience. And so I love the story, and there's a great message in there about Derek and not giving up. But there's also one about his dad. Because I found myself having tripped and fallen. I didn't get into the helping profession by accident. I got through it through the lens of my own experience. I got through it by needing grace way more than I could ever get it because I had faceplant. I found myself dealing with depression and numbing in and out in all kinds of unhealthy ways. And the right people came around me at the right time, and the lights came back on. And I thought, I want to commit my life to going and doing this. And I did. And then I found myself many years into my career, exhausted, burned out, working 18 hours a day and sleeping on the couch. All in the name of helping people. They never told me that it would be hard. They never told me that I would go down from time to time. And I'm okay going down, but nothing can keep me down. What I needed, and maybe what we all need, not just now but always, is a big permission slip to allow each other to come alongside each other the way Derek Redmond's father did. Fight through the awkwardness, fight through the discomfort, and fight through the security, and whatever stands in our way to walk alongside each other, lift each other up, and be with each other. That's what we get to do. It's not our job to push or pull people where we think they need to go. It's our job to join them. In my experience is, I'm twice as likely to walk right up here on the edge, and the edge for me is, how do I get real and get honest before the fall? How do I get real and tell you guys I'm struggling? I've struggled, and I'm going to struggle again. What I know is I'm twice as likely to walk up here and stand on the edge of my discomfort, because sometimes it can feel like the Grand Canyon. You ever feel like that when you really want to get truth, really want to get honest with somebody about how you're doing and not just say fine? You know what fine stands for? Freaked out, insecure, neurotic, and emotional. Think about that next time you say it. Or somebody says it to you, I'm fine. You're like, oh, one of those. I think I'm twice as likely to walk up here on the edge if I can walk up here with someone standing beside me, not with someone with their hand planted firmly in the middle of my back. When I drop the agenda and stop pushing and pulling people and welcome and love people, then I get to experience what it is that we talk about so well, because we message well. We as a community, we message well. We go talk about grace and we talk about love, but do we receive it? What is it that quiets your voice? Your voice is. My friend Brene Brown defines connection as the energy that exists between people when they feel seen, heard, and valued, and when they can give and receive without judgment, and when they derive substance and strength from a relationship. And at the end of the day, the why for me and the why for us is because we deserve it. We don't have to earn it. We deserve it. You know why we deserve it? Because we showed up. You know what we just, you know what we really want? We show up at our gut. You know what we want? We want to be seen, heard, and valued. We want to feel connected. We want to practice connection. We want to walk in here and be real with each other. Because when we walk in here and we're real with each other, we don't walk out with more information. We walk out with a bigger heart. And we walk out being able to practice these things with the people closest to us, because that's the hardest place to practice it. I'm armed with all these tools, and I do it with you well. You're strangers to me. But when I go home and talk to my family, sometimes they go right out the window. And I believe when we stop talking about grace as a concept and move it into a reality, then we get to mirror and model the very thing we want and ask people to be a part of us. That's who we are. That's who we're becoming. Last week, I talked to some really smart kids. They're kids. Am I getting that old? Yeah, they're Pepperdine Law School. They're not kids. I guess they're young adults. So I talked to some really smart people at Pepperdine Law School, and I went in. It was a class on failure. And I thought, I got that. I can teach that. I've had plenty of it. And I had no nerves. I had a lot of nerves coming in here today because I was trying to qualify myself. I was like, they got to know what I know. If they don't know what I know, they won't trust me. I went in there thinking, I know failure. I can do this. But when I got there, we first sat down, and the dean of the school and some other important people were there, faculty members, who happened to just show up that day to come and audit the class that day. And I really respect my friend who teaches that class. And so the way he introduced me and teed me up was this. He walked in. He said, I want you guys to meet my friend Miles. He's amazing. He shows up for a lot of people in pain. He saved so many marriages and done so much great stuff. He's really good with relationships. He works with all these people. And every word he said, I wanted to crawl straight under the table. You ever feel like that when somebody's affirming you or giving you a compliment? It's like if they just knew. But all I could think about was, okay, how do I show them what you know? Tell them what you know and then get the heck out of here. And so I did. I just shook my head and received it. But I really had a lot of fear. Like if they really knew who they got. And so I go in, I teach a class, and right before I go up, I say, well, I've had plenty of experiences. You sure you want me to talk about all these? He said, you could. You can talk about what happened to you 15 years ago, 10 years ago. All that's great. He said, but you know what really is interesting to people is what you're struggling with now. That's another proposition. I was like, I'm not sure I signed up for that. So I did that. I danced in my comfort for almost the entire talk. I was like, I struggled with this, struggled with that, dropped here, fell there. But I never got to current time. And finally I said, so earlier when I met some of the faculty, what you don't know about me is that, yes, I have helped a lot of people with relationships, and I'm not married. Disqualifier number one. I'm not actually very good at relationships. I actually struggle with them. Disqualifier number two. I blacked out after that. I don't know what else I said. But I thought, what if they knew my truth? What if I could tell them my truth? You know why I tell people my truth, and you know why I think we deserve to tell people our truth, is because the truth always ends with an and. Because there's always more. And it's okay to tell people where we are and what we struggle with, because there's an and. And you know what the and was for me? Is I got up there and I got to say, I'm not married, which doesn't make me feel very good about helping people with relationships. I'm not blah, blah, blah. And I've worked my tail off at relationships. I have worked my tail off at becoming a better human being. And I'm getting married in 2 weeks. And that's a true story. And I'm terrified I'm going to fail. Because I've worked with people. I know how hard it is. I'm going in. I'm getting married a little later. And a lot of people say this. For those of you that aren't, you know, everybody says it's about time. And I said, no, it's not about time, it's the right time. It's the right time. I'm proud of who's showing up today, and I know I'm going to mess it up, and I'm proud of who's showing up today because I stand in grace. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest in me. Let's flip the script. Weakness is not what we were told it is. Vulnerability is not weak, it's strength. Going through what any of us may be going through with change is not an obstacle. It may be our biggest opportunity. It's not how we fall, it's how we rise. And what we cannot do alone, we do together. We rise together. We lead together. We love together. We do grace together. At the end of the day, that's what it's all about. So how do we do it? This is what I love about this community. And if you're visiting, buckle up. It's a fun group. Is we get out of the box. I don't even know if we have a box. I think we kicked the box down. And you know what I say? Go back to what works. Let's get out of the box. Let's don't see people for who they've been or who they are. Let's see people for who they're becoming. Let's don't try to hotwire pain and pretend like this doesn't challenge us and concern us and that we don't have questions. It's okay to not be okay. Remember that? If that's really true, that anything's possible, everybody's welcome, because nobody's perfect. We can be in that. We can be in this in hope. We can be in this in resilience. We can be in this in pain. We can do this. My friend Brad gets out of the box all the time. He creates these amazing opportunities, these just random social experiments to love people and to give them some grace. And this is one of them that I really like. So we'll land the plane with this.
Here comes the runner.
Could I run with you?
Sure.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Hey, could I run with you?
Yeah.
Can I just join your jog?
Let's do it.
I'm just about done, but I'll go with you at the end.
Okay, I'm Asia.
Morgan.
Nice to meet you, Morgan.
Morgan.
30 seconds.
They're coming towards you, station one.
First time going up.
Now.
Thank you.
that's what we get to do. Is we got the other side of this is the beauty in our most broken moments. And so if you're out there today and you're having one, and you may not be, maybe in the best time of your life, maybe in the worst time of your life, if you're out there and you have one, know this, that joy and resilience are on the way. And we will be with you at your worst, and we will be with you at your best. That's what we get to do for each other. And we got to celebrate each other along the way. And sometimes we don't need to know what's happening. We just need to love each other along the way. And I love that. There's been times in my life it was so dark that my prayer was this. I would wake up the morning and say, whatever. And when I went to bed at night, I'd say, enough. That prayer counts. We count. So the why? Because you deserve it. You deserve it. We deserve it. You deserve it. The people out there in the world that are hurting today deserve it. We deserve to be in the conversation. We're having the hard conversation. So let's do it together. So Amy Cuddy, we'll close with this, is a friend of mine, and she's a Harvard psychologist, really smart, but came up with some cool research on body language. And one of the things she discovered was that when runners cross a finish line, what do? This. Every time. And so they thought initially that that was because of imprint learned. We see it at some point in our life, so we just think that's what you do, until they researched and saw what blind runners do when they cross the finish line. People who've never seen in their lives, and what do? Boom. So you know, actually, if you do that, it actually lowers your ambient stress level. If you do that before you walk into some kind of stressful situation, they call it power poses. You're going to look really weird. So if you guys would stand up with me. And Nashville, all the campuses and online, you're going to really look weird if you're online in public somewhere. But this is going to be the way we're going to pray it out today. We're no longer going to be who we've been or who we are. We're going to be who we're becoming. We're going to celebrate together. So we're going to cross the finish line all at once, and we're going to give it some noise. And so 1, 2, 3. Bless you guys. Have a great week. Thanks for being here.